My name is Soma Jyonouchi. I'm one of the immunologists here at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. And today we're going to be talking about flow cytometry and severe combined immune deficiency. So the goals of this talk are to provide an overview of flow cytometry and then apply the use of flow cytometry in the diagnosis of severe combined immune deficiency. Flow cytometry is a rapid method of counting labeled lymphocytes, which include T cells, B cells, and natural killer cells. And most patients with severe combined immune deficiency have absent T cells, and they may or may not also have absent B cells and natural killer cells. It's really one of the most useful initial tests to obtain when you're suspecting a patient to have severe combined immune deficiency. Typically, the result will be available in about 24 hours. And in contrast, genetic testing that may confirm severe combined immune deficiency can take months to complete. So the first step after you collect blood from a patient is to separate out the PBMC layer, shown here. And you can use this using a substance called ficol. And ficol separates out the erythrocytes and granulocytes from the PBMC layer that contains your lymphocytes that you're interested in. So the next step is to label the cells. So if you are trying to identify T cells, you can label the T cells with a fluorescently labeled antibody directed against CD3. And if you're interested in finding B cells, you can label the B cells with a fluorescently labeled antibody directed against CD19 or CD20. The final step is to send the sample into the flow cytometer. The labeled sample is sucked into the flow cytometer, and the cells actually enter the flow cytometer single file, and eventually it will hit this laser in the flow cytometer. And when the sample hits the laser will lead to emission of fluorescence from the labeled antibody. This is the laser coming in here, hitting the fluorescently labeled antibody. Then within the flow cytometer, there are fluorescent detectors that can rapidly count the cells at a very rapid pace, up to several thousand per second. And this is an example of the data that's collected when the sample goes through the flow cytometer. This is a dot plot, and in this figure, each single dot represents an individual cell that has been detected by the flow cytometer. In this example here, we have CD19 on the x-axis, and CD19 identifies B cells. On the y-axis, we have CD3, and CD3 identifies T cells. So the CD3 positive cell population here are your T cells, and the CD19 positive cell population here are your B cells. Now here is an example from a patient with known immune deficiency. You can see that this patient has a normal population of CD3 positive T cells. But when you look at the CD19 positive B cells, there are almost no cells detected in this patient. And this is a patient that is known to have X-linked agammaglobulinemia, which is a condition in which patients have no B cells due to a mutation in the BTK gene. So I wanted to show you an example of a normal lymphocyte panel. And this is a lymphocyte panel from a six-month-old infant. The main points that I would look at typically in a lymphocyte panel, I'd first start out with the CD3 positive T cells. And I typically focus on the absolute numbers rather than the percentages. So CD3 T cell counts. I also look at the CD4 and CD8 T cell populations. Typically, you'd want to have twice as many CD4 counts as CD8 T cells, and that'll give you a CD4 to CD8 ratio around 2 or greater. Other important T cell markers that I typically look at include the CD45 RA T cells and the CD45 RO T cells. The RA are your naive T cells, the RO are your memory T cells. In an infant of this age, you should have 10 times as many naive T cells as memory T cells. And that'll create a naive to memory T cell ratio of about 10 to 1, which is exactly what you see for this infant. Next, you'll want to focus on the CD19 or CD20 positive B cell population. And then finally, the CD3 negative, CD16, and CD56 positive cells are your natural killer cells. So let's go over a couple cases to illustrate the concepts of flow cytometry. So case number one, this is a 3-month-old male who is admitted to our hospital for respiratory distress. He is para-influenza positive, and he's intubated and transferred up to the pediatric ICU. This is the initial lymphocyte panel that's obtained for this patient. And starting with the CD3 positive T cells, you can see this patient at 3 months of age should typically have a CD3 positive T cell count of several thousand, around 4,000 or 5,000. And this patient has a CD3 T cell count of 25. So markedly reduced. The patient's CD19 positive B cell population is about 1,100, which is normal. However, the patient's natural killer cell numbers are also reduced at 78. So this is what we would refer to as a T negative, B positive, NK negative phenotype on flow cytometry. This patient also had immunoglobulin levels drawn. You can see the IgG level was normal for this patient, but remember this is a 3-month-old, so this IgG level is likely maternal in origin. We also looked at T cell function by looking at lymphocyte proliferation in response to the mitogens PHA, pokeweed mitogen, and ConA. And I'll just point out briefly that this patient had a stimulation index of 2, 1, and 2. And you can see in contrast, the control patient had a stimulation index of 300, 600, and about 150. So markedly reduced lymphocyte function. So when we think about a patient with a T negative, B positive, and K negative phenotype, we think about two diagnoses the most. The first is X-linked severe combined immune deficiency, which results from mutations in the IL-2 receptor gamma. And the second is JAK3 deficiency. And in fact, this patient was confirmed to have a mutation in the IL-2 receptor gamma by gene sequencing and was thus diagnosed with X-linked SCID. And the patient received a haploidentical transplant from his mother, and he's currently doing well. One important point that I'll point out is that this mutation confirmation occurred about 2 months after the patient was transplanted. So we do not wait for confirmation by genetic testing to perform life-saving transplant for a patient with very high suspicion of severe combined immune deficiency. So second case, this is a 7-month-old female admitted with RSV and rhinovirus infection. She is hypoxic, has an oxygen of 80% on room air, and is transferred also to the pediatric ICU. This is a CBC with differential that was available for the patient when we were first consulted. And what's striking about the CBC is that if you calculate this patient's absolute lymphocyte count by multiplying the white blood cell count by the lymphocyte percentage, you get an absolute lymphocyte count of about 1,000, which is very low for an infant. You should really have an absolute lymphocyte count of around 4,000 or 5,000 at this age. So second case, this is a 7-month-old female admitted with RSV and rhinovirus infection. She is hypoxic, has an oxygen of 80% on room air, and is transferred also to the pediatric ICU. This is a CBC with differential that was available for the patient when we were first consulted. And what's striking about the CBC is that if you calculate this patient's absolute lymphocyte count by multiplying the white blood cell count by the lymphocyte percentage, you get an absolute lymphocyte count of about 1,000, which is very low for an infant. You should really have an absolute lymphocyte count of around 4,000 or 5,000 at this age. So this is the patient's lymphocyte panel by flow cytometry. And again, starting with the CD3 T cell count, you can see that the CD3 count of 34 is markedly reduced. It should be several thousand. This patient has a normal B cell population of 1,300. And this patient also has a normal natural killer cell population of 443. So this is what we would refer to as a T negative, B positive, NK positive phenotype. This patient had a low IgG and IgA levels. And this patient's lymphocyte proliferation was also markedly reduced. You can see the stimulation index for this patient is 5, 7, and 2 versus 2,000, 1,000, and about 1,800 for the control patient. So when we think about the differential diagnosis for a T-negative, B-positive, NK-positive form of SCID, we think of IL-7 receptor deficiency. We think of deficiencies of the CD3 complex. We also think of CD45 deficiency, or 20TQ11.2 deletion syndrome with complete lack of thymus. This patient was confirmed to have a mutation in the IL-7 receptor gene and received a matched sibling transplantation and is doing well currently. So case number 3, this is a 2-month-old female, X33-week premature infant. She has a history of E. coli sepsis and enterococcus urinary tract infection. She's admitted to the hospital for evaluation of very poor weight gain, but while admitted, she develops a cough and an oxygen requirement. And this is the initial CBC that is obtained for this patient. What you'll notice here is the absolute lymphocyte count is 100. Normal, again, for an infant of this age group would be an absolute lymphocyte count of about 4,000 or 5,000. So this is markedly reduced. And this is the initial lymphocyte panel that's obtained for this patient. First, starting again with the CD3 T cell count. The T cell count is 178, which is very low. The patient's B cell count is 9, which is also markedly reduced. And the natural killer cell count is 58, which is low. So this patient has only 8% T cell function when mitogen proliferation was performed. And this patient was also found to have pneumocystis jervesi pneumonia, which explains the significant oxygen requirement. So this patient has a T-negative, B-negative, NK-negative phenotype based on the flow cytometry. And when we think about this phenotype, we often think of ADA deficiency, PNP deficiency, and also reticular dysgenesis if the patient has additional neutropenia on top of the lymphopenia. So this patient was found to have low ADA enzyme levels and normal PNP levels. She also had a markedly elevated deoxyadenosine nucleotide toxic metabolite levels, and was confirmed to have a ADA deficiency. And she received a transplant which was haploidentical and is doing well. So fourth case, this is a 7-day-old healthy male who's referred to our clinic for a positive SCID newborn screen based on a TREC assay. He's well appearing, he's growing well. It's really the picture of perfect health at this point. So this was the initial lymphocyte panel that we performed on this patient due to the positive newborn screen. And you can see, starting with the CD3 positive T cells again, the T cell count is 18, which is very low. The patient had a normal B cell count of about 1,000. This patient also has a reduced natural killer cell numbers. So this is a T-negative, B-positive, NK-negative phenotype in this well-appearing child identified by newborn screen. His T-cell function was found to be only 3% of the control. And this patient was diagnosed with JAK3 deficiency by gene sequencing. And this patient received a matched sibling transplant and is doing well. So in summary, I hope I've shown you that flow cytometry is a wonderful rapid technique for counting labeled lymphocytes. It's really the first line test to perform when you're concerned about a patient with possible severe combined immune deficiency. And it's also really the first test of choice to perform when you have a patient that's identified by a positive newborn screening for SCID.